So, like I said, it's modeled after a 1930s radio is sort of the inspiration for it. It's I can show you the schematic for the tube amp. It's basically a Fender Champ tube amp. And then I modified it, like, hardly enough to matter. I basically put this switch in. It's the standby switch that's right here. So this is all kit parts. It's a kit that you can get through the club. And I just changed out this one standby switch. And the reason why I put the standby switch in is what this does. This is the original power switch. So when you turn the actual power switch on, it turns on the rectifier tube, which runs basically your 6.5 volts out to the filaments and the three tubes, or the two tubes, the two triads and the pinto. So it runs the filaments in those so they warm up, and when you actually hit the standby switch, it actually runs your audio, or it actually amplifies in each tube. So you don't cold knock the tubes if I put the standby switch in it. But the rest of it is all kit parts. It's all exactly the same as what you would buy out of the kit. And then this is the actual comparator circuit. So that's what makes all the lights flash. The way it works is there's basically about two TI op-amp chips. They're the quad op-amp chips. And then each op-amp is acting as a comparator. So there's this resistor network that basically gets plus 6 volts, and then it runs through the network to the positive terminal on each one of these op-amps. And then there's another input signal comes in and is split on each op-amp. So each one of these resistors is a different value. And basically what it does is it puts a different voltage at each one of these nodes. And then as this input signal gets bigger, it's changing. It's basically going to get bigger on one terminal. And once it's greater than this terminal, it outputs minus 6 volts. And then there's a diode pointing this way. And when it's minus 6 volts, this is all plus 6 volts. So the diode turns on. And then you're dropping the voltage across the diode so the light comes on. So it's actually a really simple circuit. It wasn't too bad to get it set up and working. I did a lot of different sort of prototypes to get it set to where I wanted it to be in terms of swapping out resistor values. Because this is, in the guitar, this is a really little input signal. So I actually used a separate chain as just a non-inverting amplifier to get this, like the actual incoming voltage on here a little bit bigger so that my comparator voltage, like the gaps here, don't have to be so little. So it wasn't too bad to get it working. I did all of it in lab over last semester. It was pretty simple. So, and this is the actual, on the back of this tube, I have pictures. I'll show you in the Emger folder. But basically, this is the actual, the boarded comparator circuit. So here's the two TI chips. And these are, my resistor network is in here. It's horribly buried. And these are the outputs to all the different strands of LEDs. And then there's a terminal block that all the different inputs from the amplifier run into. It's basically just plus or minus, I think this is plus or minus 12 volts. And then there's an input from the guitar input, and there's a ground, and that's it. So it's pretty simple. And then you're going to go to, let's do the prototype comparator first. Because this is just a YouTube video of the first time I got it to work in lab. It's basically, it's just I put it on a protoboard and then ran the function generator through it, I think with one on 1 hertz sine waves. And it's just, you can see it as it moves up and down. It looks just like a VU meter. It's basically the same circuit for a VU meter. It took me like a month to get this to work properly, and so when this happened, I took all kinds of horrible iPhone pictures with it, and this is the result of that. But yeah, so it's just running into the function generator. It's pretty simple. It looks, like I said, just like a VU meter. And then that was the basic circuitry that goes into the tube. So if you go back to the Emger album, all the woodworking, that's what took me, it took me about 4 months to plan, and then I did it all in 3 days. So this is basically my first outline of how I wanted to put the case together. So I did all of this in Photoshop, which wasn't the best idea. I didn't have CAD on my laptop, I had Photoshop, so I drew the whole thing in Photoshop. So this is basically the front face, and this is the top view, and then the side view. And then yeah, if you scroll down, I did this design in Photoshop as well. This is modeled after like an old Zenith radio. So on the older radios they had, these were like your wavelengths, and so you dialed them in. And so I just basically took that and then copied it onto my own dimension, like with my own circles. And I've built this insignia that's just my initials with a cool sort of script in the center. And then I printed that onto basically a piece of contact paper, and then that's what's sitting on the backside of this piece of plexiglass. And then this is the actual amp and amp chassis that I built through the club. So this is what, if you order all the parts of the club, this is what you'll get. And I just ordered two different knobs on Mojo Tones and then a different light. And all the rest of it is exactly the same as what came out of the kit. And then yep, here's the back view. And then this is the first mock-up I did. So before I actually built this one, this is built out of walnut, which is harder to find and a little bit expensive. So I built the first one out of basically plywood just to make sure my dimensions were right and that I could get the right arches on the amp. So that's what the first one is. And then this is my mock-up too of how I was gonna get the tube. Because like I said, this has some depth in it. Like the LEDs aren't right behind this glass. They're actually back behind this piece of tube. And then this is from the bottom view. So this tube is sitting against the top panel and these little arches that I cut out, and then I just put the tube down in there. And then what I did is I took all these LEDs, and this is like after I did just the first mock-up to make sure that this would work, but I basically wired every single LED in parallel, and I think there's 8 LEDs per strand, and there's 6 strands in the entire little backlight. And if you scroll down, I think there's a picture of that. Yeah, so this is after I got 3 strands done. I just basically illuminated them all and checked it, and it worked. And then that's all the final like strands. So they're in this sort of star pattern, and then I cut all the stubs and cleaned them up, and then I glued them, hot glued them all down. So they're all sitting on the piece of plexiglass that has foil mounted behind it. This is all glue as it was drying. So now if you look at it, this is reflective. So it moves the light down the tube a little better than it did before. And this is as the tube, or as the glue was still drying, I trimmed it. So it's actually trimmed to the face. So this is what is basically sitting in the back of that tube. If you scroll down, I think there's a picture of that. Yep, so that's the tube. So if you were to take off this piece of plexiglass, that's what you would see. It's right down the tube. There's basically a ton of LEDs all glued together. That's the backboard mount. So all of the circuitry and everything was put on a board on the back of it. And that's what that was too. And then we talked about the terminal one. And then to power it all, I actually found this old cell phone charger in lab. It was just beat up, and the plus and minus leads out of it were frayed at the connector, so somebody threw it away. But I cracked the case off of it, and then I checked it like with a DMM, and it was all fine. Like it was still outputting just fine, and it's actually pretty clean. There's not too much ripple because there's a big capacitor on it. But I basically what I ended up doing is I tied it. So this is just my line in from the wall. And it's tied over into the input on the transformer. And then it's just right in parallel with the big power transformer. And this is all insulated on the bottom, so it's not, you know, sending plus and minus, I think, plus and minus 12 into the case. It's nice and wrapped. But this is the leads I use for the comparator. And that was my first test of the comparator with the actual, this is frosted plexiglass as opposed to just normal plexiglass. It makes it look a little prettier. So that was my first test with it. And then to actually cut these arches out, if you look at it now, you can see these seams on it. So to actually get these arches to all be the same, I actually did paper mock-ups first from that original plot, the first one I showed you in Photoshop. I printed a 1-to-1 dimension of that, which is basically a 24-by-24 piece of paper. And then I cut out all of these arches. And then with the arches, I basically glued them onto a piece of wood and then cut the wood right along the arch. So if you scroll down, I think there's a... Yeah, so this is what I did is I took each one of these pieces and glued them all together and clamped them down so they're nice and flat, and these are all flush. So that was basically to get my first, that's the front arch. And if you scroll down there, it should be, yep, and there's the rest of the front arch. So there's this arch piece, the center section, and then there's a piece right here, and there's two pieces here, and then there's a bottom piece. So there's a lot of actually, like, it was a lot of sort of forethought to make sure it all mapped together to make it look symmetric. So that was gluing the front and the back pieces together. And then the thing that was really difficult about this that took me so much time to plan out is to get this arch, this like actual top piece, to get the wood, this is what's called veneer, and it's I think 1/32 of an inch thick. So it's incredibly thin. So in order to actually give this some like structural integrity, like in the curves, what I ended up doing is taking a piece of plexiglass and curving it to the basically the same radius as this. And then I took a router and I routed a lip on the inside of this and then glued this piece of plexiglass right in the lip. So there's actually a piece of plexiglass that runs from here to there on the whole curve of the top of the amp that's just flush with the top front and the front and back face. And then after I did that, I put the veneer on the top, and then that's how I got basically this sort of arch shape with the clean flush piece. So it looks like one piece of wood, but it's really a ton of pieces of wood. And that's the first, after I stained it, I put the amp in to just make sure it would fit. And then the next one is the actual amp installation. So to get the chassis to sit in here, there's basically two sheet metal screws on either side that are holding it pinned in place in either corner. And then the two, like with the comparators in it, sitting right on top. And then there's a nice gap. This is all open face in the back. So the power cord runs out the open face in the back, and then the actual speaker output runs out, and the tubes have room to breathe because of these the mesh finishes in the top, and the two corners actually help run air down through the amplifier to cool the tubes in the back. And there's the first, all the shots I took. In total, it was definitely worth the time I put into it. It sounds really good. The cool thing about the Champ is that since it's like a smaller amplifier, it's not too high in wattage, so you can kind of crank it a lot and it won't blow you up. Like, I have a Hot Rod Deluxe that I play on as well. And since this one's smaller, you can get the tubes to really saturate without having a lot of volume, whereas in my Hot Rod Deluxe, to get the tubes to saturate, it's incredibly loud. So I really like having this amp. It's pretty cool. And the build turned out pretty well, so it was worth it. But yeah, for the most part, that was it. It wasn't incredibly hard. I think the hardest part in all of it was the woodworking, but the actual putting the kit together wasn't too bad, and same thing with the comparator. The comparator, most of the stuff I got for that, I found circuits online and then changed the schematic a little bit to get what I wanted. But it wasn't too bad. So, yep. Are there any questions?
Can you show us it working?
Yeah, so I can turn it back on. Yep.
The daisy chains and locks got to keep the loonies on the path.
Probably $50 for the electronics and $150 for the wood and the mesh. So I put another $200 into it, and then I actually put it on Reddit. I put it in We Are the Music Makers, like r-We Are the Music Makers, and a couple people actually gave me offers to buy it from me. And the highest offer I got was $750, which would have been basically covering all of my profits, like all the money I put into building it plus $350 in profits. So it was, I don't know, it wasn't too bad. Like I said, it wasn't a huge investment, and it was worth it because the value is definitely there. So,
roughly how many hours did it take you to put the whole thing together?
To put the amp together, I think it took me, I would say 12 hours to put the amp together, and that was over the course of about 2 months working in lab. And then the woodworking probably took me another 12 hours, but that was, like I said, I did it in 3 days over Christmas break. So it was like I sat down and then just sort of like binge woodworked. And a lot of that was just sort of watching blue dry, because it's not especially complicated. The hardest part was getting the arches and the front and the back to be symmetrical, because I cut them out on a bandsaw, and then I was like, oh, they'll be fine. And then I looked at them and they were not at all close. So I actually took a oscillating sander and I basically just machined them all like really slowly, and like I did this for way too long. And then once they were all approximately the same, I glued them, and then I took the two faces, the front and the back, and then ran those through the sander, and so it was all really spot on by the time it was done. And then I clamped it and glued it, and by the end it was pretty much done. So that took me, yeah, about 12 hours in total to get it assembled. But once it was assembled, yeah, it wasn't too bad. So
yeah, the kit was around $200 or so.
Yep. So it was about twice as much to put it in the case. So, and the comparator, I think the two TI chips I got were probably the most expensive part of the comparator, and they were like maybe $1.50. So it was very simple. I had the board I put it on was lying around in a toolbox I had somewhere, so it wasn't too hard to put together. So.
Any other questions?
Cool.
All right. Thanks, Phil.
Yep.